Well, good morning, church. I'd like to welcome you to Williamstown First Baptist Church in Williamstown, Massachusetts. Thank you for being here with us this morning, dear friends. We're going to hear a great message this morning from Brother Chuck on the issue of model spouses. Now, guys, if you're tuning in order to acquire some tips on how to attract a trophy wife, I don't think that's exactly what we mean by model spouses, but rather what behavior should we model as spouses in our Christian walk. So I'm sure in that regard, Chuck is going to be using me as an example over and over again, because after all, who wouldn't want this? Just asking, okay? But thank you again for being here. Before we begin this morning with our song service, our call to worship today is from the book of Genesis, chapter 1. I love Genesis 1, verses 26 and 27. And of course, if you're reading along in your pew Bible, it's on page 1. Then God said, "Let us make man in our own image, after our likeness. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we rejoice in your created order. Father, we thank you for making us men and women in your own image. Father, as we meet this morning, inform us, Lord, guide us, teach us, and show us how to conform our lives to the order which you have established for your family and for our individual families. Father, thank you once again. Guide our service this morning, Lord, and all God's people said, amen. Hallelujah. Well, if you'd stand and join me, we're going to begin this morning with hymn number 575 in our celebration hymnal, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in the pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. Have blessed peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. right, you can be seated.
Yeah, and we'll spend a few minutes in prayer. I want to keep Char Lawson in prayer today. Had a little bit of a setback, but she's hopefully on the road again. So please keep Char in prayer. And Ron and Char James, their daughter Donna, has tremendous back pain, and she'll be operated on Thursday of this week. They were praying it would be sooner. So keep her in prayer as well. Do we have others this morning that we should be praying for? Sure, Helen?
Pray for Colleen.
Pray for Colleen, who has some health.
She has her baby, but she has heart problems and high blood pressure.
Yeah, Helen's daughter, Colleen, who has heart issues and high blood pressure and is due any time. And we will pray for her. And how many will that be, Helen? How many?
Seven.
Okay. We'll pray the Lord blesses. Yes, to pray. Yeah. And well, also want to pray for Bill and Vera. Vera and Bill had a difficult week. So we'll keep them in prayer. I want to pray for Williamstown this morning, standing in back and looking out the door as Tom was about to begin. And I think we need to be more persistent, pointed in our prayers for the community in which God has placed this church. We want the Lord to move here by His Spirit and to bring many into the kingdom, and He can do that. Certainly we want to pray for the surrounding areas from which many of us are, but we want to pray specifically for Williamstown. This is where God has put this church, here next to Williams College. And as the new year is about to begin, to be in prayer, earnest prayer, that God's Spirit would move powerfully. All of us can give a testimony that we were saved when we weren't looking for God. And certainly, many here might not be. But God can break through that, introduce Himself, and give them a passion for Him and for His Word. And so we're going to pray and we're going to ask for that specifically in these next weeks. Let's bow our heads. Father, we do pray for Char, for Lawson, for her hip and her legs as they try to bear up under. No pun intended, Lord, bear up under the hip, that they would all heal well together without any consequence, that she might be restored to regular, normal life very quickly and be restored here and to her friends. Pray for Donna, Ron and Char's daughter. Pray that you ease her pain as she awaits surgery. Pray even that you move that surgery up so that it would happen sooner, that you guide the doctors, give them the skill necessary to accomplish what's needed and relieve the pain that she's suffering, and take care of her two children, Lord, as she's enduring this, please. We do pray for Colleen. We pray for her health. We pray for a safe delivery for both her and her child, and that we pray for your provision in the weeks after, that the child would be taken care of and Colleen would be provided for as well. Father, we pray for Williamstown. You've put this church here. You've called us to be a light in this community. And so we pray that your Spirit will use that light to call many into your kingdom. If there's something that we can do to make you known, please show it what it might be. Help us to accomplish that. Give us whatever gifts are necessary to do it. Give us the courage. Give us the wisdom, the love, the forgiveness to proclaim your word to those around us, specifically here. To know how to evangelize, to tell others about you. lift up your name. Make us, as we are studying here in this book, make us model servants, model spouses, model citizens and subjects, that others might be drawn to you, might see a difference between us and the world. Lord, we earnestly plead for your help to do this. We have so many that we love that don't know you. And as we pray for Williamstown, we pray for our loved ones, that you would call them into your kingdom, work powerfully in their lives. Lord, help us to know what to do, what to say, what not to say, and then bless our words by your Spirit in all these instances, and grow your church, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. Please stand, and we'll praise our God.
We have in Jesus all our sin and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer.
Let's try that line again. This time we're going to sing it in the right key. Sorry about that, dear friends. I'm only a model spouse. I'm not necessarily a model worship leader. Hallelujah.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sin and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden? Cumbered with a load of care. Precious Savior, still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross until my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, the old rugged cross, so despised by the world, holds a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In the old rugged cross, so stained with blood, so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glories forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for crown. This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears. All nature sings, and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning bright, the lily white, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear Him pass. He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one.
Amen. And please turn to page 1015 in the Pew Bibles or in your own Bible to 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 1. And the Lord is answering our prayer. Lena had to turn the candles off, so to speak, because the wind, the spirit, was blowing powerfully and it was flickering. We pray that that's an indication indeed that God is moving. And often we don't see Him moving. We see the result, like the flames flickering. And so we pray that we'll see that in people's lives that we love. God moving, God working. Amen. So this morning we're going to continue in 1 Peter. And we're going to be looking at marriage this morning. Model spouses. So let me read verses 1 to 7 of chapter 3, and then we'll pray and ask the Lord to speak to us this morning. Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives, when they see your respectful and pure conduct. Do not let your adorning be external, the braiding of hair, the putting on of gold jewelry, or the clothing you wear. But let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart, with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's sight is very precious. For this is how the holy women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, by submitting to their own husbands, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. And you are her children if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening. Likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. And Father, you see these verses. You penned them a long time ago through Peter for our benefit and the benefit of all who might read them until your return. And we need your blessing that your Spirit indeed would move this morning and proclaim this text to our hearts, show its applicability to our lives and to this culture. Help us to submit ourselves to your will and to live accordingly, Lord, in this world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We had a saying in seminary, that'll preach. You know, there are certain texts. Boy, they're, you know, if God is with us, who can be against us? Well, that'll preach. Everybody gets excited about knowing that God is for you. Women, be subject to your own husbands. That'll preach. Right? In this century, in this culture. So we first need, as we look at this text, as we do any time we look at a text in Scripture, to see the context. We need to remind ourselves of why we're here, what we've been told, and then see this in the context of all of that. We're here because we were told back in chapter 2, verse 9, that God did all the things for us that he did. He caused us to be born again. He gave us an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, kept in heaven for us. And he guards us by faith so that we might have that inheritance on the day that Christ returns. He's done all these things for us. So now that we might proclaim his praises to a people that remains in darkness, the darkness from which he called us out of. And now he's going to tell us, he has been telling us, how exactly we proclaim those praises. And surprisingly, perhaps to us, when we think of preaching the word, he's been emphasizing conduct, how we live in the world. And we know that that's true. What we do is frequently of greater import than what we say. Our works have to match our words. And you had heard the old saying, I can't hear what you're saying. Your works are speaking too loudly. I can't hear over the din. As we tell our children, perhaps, not to smoke as we pull a pack of Marlboros out and begin smoking. And, you know, that's just an easy illustration. You know, you shouldn't swear. You shouldn't use foul language, as I use it, you know, every day. Shouldn't watch that on television as I do, or I go to a movie. You know, our children watch. People watch us. When I was in Williamstown working for the government, we had a letter, an internal newsletter that we sent around for a while, advising people of what was going on. The title of it was the Fishbowl Gazette. Fishbowl because when you're in the public eye, everybody is watching to see what you do. Well, that same thing is true of Christians. As soon as you put on that hat that says, I live for Jesus, everybody knows that you're a Yankee fan if they're not. I know, you have to stop and think about that. I do too. You identify as a Christian and you're going to have people watching. I'm having people watch. And every time I slip up, doesn't matter that they've slipped up 28 times in the past hour. If I slip up, I have said I'm a Christian. I have said I follow Christ. And so it's our conduct we're concerned with as we come to proclaiming Christ's excellencies. And Peter told us there's two things, basically, that we need to do. We need to, first of all, abstain from the passions of the flesh. Those things that we used to participate in that we're now ashamed of, we're told elsewhere in Scripture. All the things that we used to do. I was saying earlier, one of the things that saddens me is that many of the people I was part of a fraternity with 40 years ago have not matured. It's amazing. Same language, same jokes, same goals. It's amazing. All the passions that I was once part of, don't involve yourself in those. And we don't have to list those. All of us here know what those are. They are listed elsewhere in Scripture, but we're supposed to abstain from doing those things that are wrong. And then, verse 12, we're supposed to keep our conduct among the nations, the peoples. It says here, Gentiles. It's what we get our word ethnicity from, the Greek word, from the peoples. We're supposed to keep our conduct honorable. We're supposed to live rightly. Well, conduct involves what we say, what we do, how we react. I mean, it's one thing to say you love somebody. It's another thing when somebody does something and you make a face and your voice gets different. I love you. Yes. Our conduct. And so now he's going to, and he has been talking about conduct. And he's done that using a paradigm that we might be unfamiliar with, household codes. Something that was discussed by Greek philosophers, by Roman senators. All the people of that time, this is something that was familiar to the people then, because the household was looked at as the foundation of the country, and it still is. The household is the foundation of this nation. Not the Senate, the House of Representatives, not the Supreme Court or the presidency. When the foundations crumble, it doesn't matter how good the superstructure is when the foundations are crumbling. And so these household codes would address the husband and wife, would address the slaves, would address the children, would address the masters, how we were supposed to act towards one another. And so he begins doing that. And this ought to be familiar to us, because God uses things that we're familiar with in order to speak to us. In the Old Testament, it was the Ten Commandments. They were in the format of what was then a covenant treaty between a king and a lesser king whom he had conquered. It described what the superior king had accomplished, had done, and then what the lesser king was supposed to do as a consequence of that, giving general stipulations, then giving detailed stipulations, and then telling what would happen if they didn't and what they did, blessings and curses. And so that format was familiar. People could understand it, and it made it easy for them to grasp it. This would have made the people of that time would have been good, because they could have grasped it more easily. Oh yeah, I remember. This is now how we're supposed to act. But this is how a Christian is supposed to act towards the government. And even with that first message, you get a lot of pushback. You mean I'm supposed to obey, I'm supposed to do, I'm supposed to follow all of these regulations? What about the fact that I'm an American, that I have the right to free speech, that I have the right to protest, that I have the right to do all these things? And see, if we begin by looking at our rights, we will never be Christians. Never. Because Christ did not look first at his rights. If he had, he would have stayed in heaven. He came for our wrongs. He came and lived among us. And as Peter has said in the last week, to this you have been called, because Christ suffered, leaving an example so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin. Deceit wasn't found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he didn't revile again. When he suffered, he didn't threaten. See, all of these things are supposed to be true of us in all of our relationships. Because if I'm a Christian, I'm not a Christian on Sunday, and a heathen at work or in my marriage or with my kids. I can't be saying amen here and then using foul language out there. Can't do it. 24/7, every day, all day. Every day, all day. Because that's what Christ was, and that's who we emulate. He is our example. And so we live honorably in all of these instances. And of course, the first one, being subject, be subject to every human institution. Every kind of human relationship that God has established for us, back in verse 13, we're supposed to be subject. And that word, be subject, is throughout Scripture. It's not just for us. We don't seem to understand that being subject, being a servant, and the word that's used is that of a bond servant, not the one that's used here in verse 18 for a household servant who has more rights than a bond servant who had no will, no possibility of advancing, none of that. That's the kind of servant we're supposed to be, first to God. No will of our own. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God, James says. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. And even Peter here in his letter in verses 18 and 19, he talks about our conduct. If you call on him as Father, who judges impartially according to one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear, inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without spot or blemish. We are supposed to live this way, subject to God Almighty, bond servants. And we need to be those servants because those are the servants in Revelation chapter 1 to whom God made his revelation. Those are the servants in chapter 22 at the end of the book who are around the throne of God and worshiping Christ. Those are the servants that God sent the angel to show what must soon take place. You and me, if we're that kind of servant to God, not my will, but your will be done, then we are around the throne hearing God's testimony. But if we're not, we won't. And so that kind of servant will serve God by being subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution. It's an imperative. It's not a suggestion. This is our God whom we serve telling us this is what you must do. And it's a word that's used of Christ in submission to his Father. I do his will. I only do those things that please him. Christ is not asking us to do something he didn't do. When he was an example of service to his Father. And so therefore, to the government, who at the time was Nero, as we said, who burned down Rome, under whom Peter would be martyred, we think we have bad rulers, bad officials. He was saying, be subject to Nero. Be subject to those. Unless we find this in Scripture, they want us to do something that God would call a sin. We can't call Nero Lord and call Christ Lord. And so many were martyred because they refused to do so. Many people left the arts in that time, in that century. Why? Because they were being required to do, to say, to model things that were ungodly. They took a pay cut. They changed their life. They had to move. They didn't have the income they used to, because if they stayed where they were, they would have dishonored Christ by their conduct. And so they moved on. So be subject to Nero, servants, household servants. Be subjects to your masters. And as in the previous example, which said we're to overcome evil with good, we're to put to silence the ignorance of foolish people by doing good. This one calls us to be subject even to those who are evil, even to those who are crooked, unscrupulous, perverse. For that's really the nuance of the word that's there. And so in the previous two sections, before we get to marriage, we see that in our lives, we serve God by being subject to government, to employers. That's about the closest parallel we have. It's not perfect. Even those who are ungodly. And why? Because Christ is our example. And so we're going to get, as we come to marriage, and we saw that, we're going to get similar ways of looking at things. Well, first of all, let's talk about marriage. Why marriage? I asked that in the promo. Have you ever wondered why God created marriage? It's not the easiest institution. And I only say that because as a sinner, I am going to cause pain to anyone I am with 24/7 because I'm not perfect. I'm going to misunderstand. I'm going to have a temper sometimes. I'm going to have a different idea about what to do. There's going to be friction. And since that's the one relationship that you're with somebody all the time, every day, they know you. You can buffalo somebody. I can look really good to you here in church. But you have to ask my wife. You have to ask Elena to know what I'm like 24/7. Marriage is a beautiful thing because God is using it to change us, to conform us to His image by removing those things that are ungodly in our lives, which become evident as we live with somebody. So what's happening in our society? Everybody's leaving. Why? Too much friction. Too much friction. No, this isn't good. This is not where I'm going anymore. So marriage is a beautiful thing, but it won't exist in the resurrection. We're told in the resurrection, Jesus said, there's neither marriage nor are people given in marriage, but they're like the angels in heaven. And so marriage is just for this age. Okay, so how do we understand marriage? Well, we look to its creation, and that's why we have the call to worship. God wanted to make man, and we understood language better back then. Man can be used to describe people or a human male. So let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the sea and over the birds of the heavens. Dominion. Let them subject creation to themselves. Same word. Let them have dominion over the fish, the birds, the livestock, everything on earth that moves. Everything on earth that moves. So, God said, let us make. So then God did. So, God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him. Male and female, He created him. Male and female, He created man. And so we have here very definitive use of gender language. Male and female, there are different Hebrew words that might have been used for man and woman, husband and wife. But the focus is on the sexuality, the male and the female. At the end of our reading this morning, where the husbands are told to show honor to the woman, the word there is an unusual Greek word that again focuses on the femininity of that person. There's only two genders. And if you look it up on Google, if you ask, you will get that same answer. There are X and Y chromosomes. That's it. Male and female. And so if they follow the science, as our culture is wont to say, it would give them the same answer if they listened to the science that was objective and simply repeated the results of what they determined, which ought to be truth, because God, the heavens, display the glory of God. All of God's creation display his glory for those who want to see it. But in Romans, what we're told is people rejected that because they had a different idea about what was true and what wasn't, and they wanted to worship what they wanted to worship, which primarily was themselves, their feelings, their desires. This is what I think. Two genders. That's all there are, male and female. So having been made in God's image, what would we expect? Well, we looked at this. First of all, the Trinity is hierarchical. It's the Father, it's the Son, and the Spirit. Yes, they're equal. Yes, they're peers. Yes, they're all fully God. But within the Trinity, there's a hierarchy. So if we're in his image, we will expect to see a hierarchy between male and female. God in the Trinity is fruitful, the fruit of the Spirit. Look at the world. Look at all that God does. He accomplishes all. We should see that there's honor and respect between the persons of the Trinity. Because the Father, the Son, and the Spirit have loved each other for all eternity, are respectful to each other, even in their roles. And we see that Jesus did the Father's will. The Spirit was sent by the Father and the Son. And so there is hierarchy. There is fruit that is there as well. And Jesus at one time is the subject. He subjected himself to the Father voluntarily. And at the same time, he's the head of the church. And so what would we expect if we're in his image? That there would be some way to portray his headness, and there would be some way to portray his subjection. And so, having laid all that out, wives, be subject, participle here. This is how we, if we go back, this is how we're subjects for the Lord's sake. Wives, being subject to your own husbands. Your own husbands. Being subject to your own husbands. And that word there means, as it will explain, as it has been explained, doing the will of my husband. I say, that'll preach, right? In this world, not without wrestling with it, right? Not without wrestling. Don't worry, the husbands are coming up. See, we get so focused on what we don't want to do that we don't hear all of God's command. Why should we do this? And remember, this is in the same context of the fact that the government might have people who are foolish, that we might have employers who are just downright not nice. And so, why should we do this? Because, so that, it says here, purpose clause. This is the purpose of wives doing this. So that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives when they see they're respectful and pure, no sin, won't do anything that's sinful, when they see that conduct without a word, without a word. And see, this is how Christians ought to live anyway, right? People ought to see our conduct. It ought to be pure. And so all the wife is doing, if she's living before an ungodly, unchristian husband, is doing what she ought to be doing with everyone else, but especially to her husband, being subject to his authority. And they're not to be concerned. Somehow this gets back to what Tom said about being a model anything. I go to fitness, I'm not a model anything. I can't work out that hard, especially when it comes to externals. Don't let your adorning be external. The parading of the hair, putting on of gold jewelry, or the clothing you wear. But let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit. Again, Jesus was meek and humble. When he reviled, he didn't revile. When he was cursed, he put it in God's hands. And so the wife is just simply doing what we should be doing as Christians, except she's doing it specifically with the one that Jesus said, the two shall be joined, and let no man put it asunder what God has joined. See, if we took these things seriously, first of all, we'd think about it before we got married. But if we did, we wouldn't get divorced so quickly. And so, not how I look. Not how I look. Now, don't misunderstand. We represent Christ. So we're not to be slovenly in our appearance. Not saying that at all. We're supposed to represent Christ well, with excellence. In all that we do, in the way that we look, what we say, we're supposed to be excellent model spouses, employees, servants. And so, yes, we can look nice, but if that's our focus, if that's how we are attracting our husband, then we will get what we have attracted. Someone who's interested in the external and not the internal. And the whole idea is that once we get married, usually, you know, we're all old enough, we know when our hormones were going, we didn't really think a whole lot about what was inside. We were blown away by what was outside, and we ran out and we got married. And then what happens? Well, what happens is, like what happened to the author of Case for Christ, his wife got saved. She changed. He thought, oh, my goodness, my fun-loving wife, I'm not going to be able to do anything I used to be able to do. But she was gentle. She was kind. She was smiling. She was happy. It was a completely different, and he was blown away by it. But he also said, I'm going to prove her wrong. And he tried. Challenge your husband or your wife. Prove me wrong. Investigate it. Follow the science, if you have the nerve. Follow the science. The hidden person of the heart. Why, this is how the holy women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, by submitting to their own husbands. And if we do these things, especially as a woman, then we'll fulfill what Proverbs 31 says, which is read all the time on Mother's Day. Strength and dignity are her clothing. Not fine apparel, not jewelry. She may be wearing him, but the overall is that her inward spirit overwhelms anything that she is outwardly. You ever met somebody? I mean, I have. I have a wonderful wife, so I have to say this, you know. But it's the inward that makes the attraction. It's not the outward, beautiful as she may be. It's the inward. There's a connection there. As Christians, the spirit in me and the spirit in her look at each other and say, yay! I gotta be with this person. You know? And that's what happens in churches, right? When you meet somebody who knows the Lord, boy, the spirit inside you is jumping up and down. When the preacher says something that you know is in the Bible and you know is right, what happens? The spirit in you starts jumping up and down. The spirit starts saying amen. The spirit starts saying praise the Lord. But here in the Northeast, we got our hand on our head, over our mouth, lest the spirit come out during the service. And say, amen, praise the Lord. Preach it, brother. See. And so it's that beauty, strength, and dignity. And why is that a blessing? Because, as the proverbist concludes, charm is deceitful. Oh, boy, is it. Oh, boy, is it. We know this from watching politics, right? Charm is deceitful. Anybody can turn it on. Pastor once said, get married quickly, because all you're doing is lying more and more to your wife. Your charm is not real. How do I know? I used to open up the door for my wife before we were married. And now I don't. I used to let her go before me through it. Now I don't. I used to get up and make her coffee. Now I don't. My charm was deceitful. It wasn't genuine. Charm can be deceitful, and beauty is vain. My sister has retired from many years working in a place like Williamstown Commons. I don't care what you do when you're 108, you aren't going to look the same as you do right now. If you're a woman, your beauty better be internal, and the love of your husband better be based on it. Because I'm not going to look better anyway. We all, the outward is perishing, is falling away. Our outward bodies perish day by day, but our inward man is renewed. Renewed every day. The spirit, that beauty, that inward beauty, a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. How does she demonstrate that fear of Christ, her service to Christ? She's subject to her husband. And so now, all the women sitting here, there's only a couple of us guys, men, live with your husbands in an understanding way. Understanding what? While understanding your wife. I don't know why this is so hard. I suppose because when we come into marriage, it's already a relationship where you're trying to establish your rights. And you want to make sure, oh no, I golf every day, every Thursday I golf. I go fishing every Friday. Oh no, that's what I do. I bowl. You know? And the wife has her friends. Oh, no, I'm not losing that time. You're not asking me to give that up, are you? Oh, no. See, we're so busy establishing our rights that we don't live in an understanding way with one another. The husband, who, as Christ is the head of the church, the husband is the head of the house. Oh, back to Genesis, where Christ is shown being subject and being head. In this marriage relationship, male and female, we have a head and we have a subject. And so we have the Trinity. And so a marriage, the best marriages, point to God. Because it's a mini Trinity. Myself, Elena, Holy Spirit, in us, living, bearing fruit, children, good works, all of those things, and people will be attracted to that. Husbands, live in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman, again, emphasizing her femininity, femaleness, as the weaker vessel. Weaker, physically weaker. I don't care how many times you want to believe that you're a man. How do we know? Look at people trying to change so that they can participate, not in a masculine, but in a feminine. The only way they can do these things is by taking hormones. But they don't stop being a male. And so they have an unfair advantage because the woman is the weaker vessel. God made us that way. Male and female, the weaker vessel. Treating her with honor. Where have we seen that word? Honor everyone. Honor the emperor. Honor your wife. You know, I have to ask myself as a husband, do I honor my wife by what I do? And what's the best way to honor her? Well, there's another set of household codes in the book of Ephesians. And what it says there is, husbands, love your wives as what? Christ loved the church. And what did he do for his bride? He died. So I want to say to any woman who hears this message, you're called to be subject. I'm called to die. I'm called to die. In my own opinion, as I've been asked by guys, I think jokingly when we have Bible study, maybe you're wondering, who goes first? Right? It's easy to love a guy who will die for you. It's easy to love a woman who will be subject. Who goes first? Well, Christ went first as my head. And so as a husband, I ought to go first. I ought to die. And see, neither one of these, be subject or die, is based on the person that you're being subject to or you're dying for. There's nothing here that says, I should die for this person because they deserve it or because he's nice. In fact, it says just the opposite. Even the people that aren't nice, I'm supposed to be subject to. Guess what? In my marriage, just like Christ died for me when I didn't deserve it, I am supposed to die for my wife, even though she doesn't deserve it. And she's supposed to be subject to me as the head, even though I don't deserve it. See, this is male and female. And for the husband, this is especially important because number one, there are heirs with us. They're just like me. We both get the same inheritance. There's no difference. This is not something that's all about me. It's about him. And he's given me an inheritance. And I'm representing him to the world by loving my wife, dying for her. She's representing Christ to the world by being subject to me. And we both get the same inheritance. And if I don't do these things, I won't be able to go to the Lord and pray. My prayers will be hindered. Why? Because I'm not doing what God wants. I'm not in fellowship. I'm not being subject to him if I'm not dying for you. So tough stuff, right? It always is. Christ gave us an example. And in this world, we will have trouble. And that includes in our marriages. But for each of us, it comes down to this. Are we subject to the Lord first? Are we subject to the Lord first? And we ought to be, because we are his bride. Revelation 22, I'll show you the bride coming down. I am part of a company that is called the Bride of Christ. He is my head. I am subject to him. He died for me. And so I tell others about Christ by my conduct, by how I relate to him, and talk of him and serve him. And so, surprisingly maybe, because we're so focused on what we ought to do in marriage, but the call is to be a model spouse, because he is my husband and I am the bride. Be a model spouse. Let's bow our heads. Father, please bless. Bless this message, Lord. What is of you? Please bless to our hearts and minds. What's not, Lord? Please remove. Correct me if I've been wrong in some way. Help us to wrestle with those things we're uncomfortable with. Help us to live as you would have us. Help it to be true when we call you, as Abraham was called by Sarah, Lord. Help it to be true, Lord, that I follow you and that I am a model spouse. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and praise our Lord.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks And he tells me I am his gold. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for walking with us, Lord, for talking with us, for making us your own. And Father, we pray that every day of our lives that we would live up to that calling, Lord, by being model servants, by being model citizens, by being model husbands, model wives. And most especially, Lord, that we would be model ambassadors for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you, dear friends. Please join us in the fellowship hall for coffee and snacks.